Today, as we speak of so much of deficits, whether it's the fiscal deficit, whether it's the trade deficit, but the largest deficit seems to be morality deficit. Any every day's paper, every day's news only talks about some fraud or the other. Some scam is, a scam is also a fraud. You could use different terminologies. But the reality is, there is so much of morality deficit. And you couldn't have had a better topic for this around this point in time. But I think when we talk of fraud, we essentially, we're looking at a situation where we are in a desert of decay and we are seeking to have an oasis of cleanliness in a desert of decay, which is a huge challenge. And in that context, when you look at this whole subject matter of fraud, the subject matter is ethics. The subject matter is about ethical behavior. You can have whatever tools you want to detect fraud. You can talk about fraud till the cows come home. Fraud will be there. You can never eradicate fraud. You can only mitigate fraud. But the larger concern is, in our country, our country is going down and down insofar as the morality index is concerned. It's not my view. Transparency International came out with, it has got what is called the Corruption Perception Index. In 2010, we were ranked 87th. And the Corruption Perception Index, the cleanest has a rating of 10. The most corrupt nation has a rating of 0. We are 3.1. We have slipped from 87 to 95. We are close to the sub-Saharan nations of the world. So this is the environment. Now the point I'm trying to make is when the environment has decayed, fraud is endemic. You cannot have cleanliness in an environment of decay. So there are two issues I would like to take up. First is the issue of bribery or corruption, which is also a subject matter of fraud when you're talking of corporate fraud. And when you're dealing with bribery or corruption, we must recognize the fundamental question which comes up is, what is needed? How do you bring this down to a level where India can rise up from its position of 95 to the top levels? We have a law. We have the Prevention of Corruption Act 1988. Other countries have laws too. But if you see our law, Prevention of Corruption Act 1988, it only deals with public servants. It's got nothing to do with the rest of the corporate sector. You go to United States, the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act of 1977 is supposed to be reasonably draconian, but it also has exceptions. It has an exception, like say facilitation payment is an exception. It defines bribery or corruption in a way as if you have paid, made a payment to secure an advantage for yourself as opposed to somebody else, then that's an unfair means and therefore it's bribery or corruption. But if you pay a government servant to do his job faster or what we call chai pani or whatever it is, that is facilitation payment. He's supposed to do his job. It's not corruption. So you're paying him to do his job. You're not paying him to do anything other than his job. You could have a debate as to whether that is right or wrong, whether it's moral or not, but that's the law in the United States. It's found that that hasn't eradicated corruption or bribery across the world. And therefore, you have the UK Bribery Act 2010, which is the most draconian law today. Private and public, passive and active bribery, all are covered, unlimited insofar as punishment and fines. But it is not the law. It is the enforcement of law. It is not about fraud detection. It is after fraud detection what happens. Unfortunately for us, we have a crumbling judiciary or a judicial infrastructure. We have a very active judiciary. But the infrastructure is such that you may find something today, till 20 years there will be no punishment. May not happen. So the same Foreign Corrupt Practices Act and the UK Bribery Act are so draconian, not just in the law, but in its enforcement. The classic example, and this is an example of also an example of how people can deal with it is Siemens as a company. Siemens as a company had gone down to such a level that they were bribing the way all through, their associates, everybody. Till action was taken under the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act and other regulators. They spent millions. They paid $800 million only in the United States. The amount, their payouts may not have been anything as much, but the amount which they had to pay as fines and the reputation took such a beating. What did Siemens do? They changed their entire board in the Europe. Chairman, the independent director, everybody, tone at the top. They put in terms processes. They developed business tools which will track all of this. Trained everybody, including their business partners, and have a zero tolerance culture. It's a showpiece. You must study the Siemens case study if you're really talking of how to create a culture. Because as I said, anything which you'll talk of in terms of fraud, you need to go back to why fraud arises. So that's one part when you're dealing with bribery or corruption. The second, the single largest, is what Mr. Chopra rightly said, is today financial statement fraud. If you look at the list from say 2001 onwards, whether from if you take even Enron as a starting point, we have had many before that. Even if you take from Enron as a starting point, you could call it the Swindler's List as opposed to the Schindler's List, and you'll find that role of honor is something which has the top companies of the world. So it brings us to the fundamental question. You have companies in the Fortune 500 which collapse overnight. You don't know till yesterday that it would collapse. They have the best boards, they have the best governance, the best auditors subject to oversight. They are the darling of investors. Overnight they collapse. Even a volcano when it erupts, before it erupts, there is so much of rumbling, so much of soot comes out. You know the volcano is going to erupt. But the sad part has been, and that's the concern, is financial statements frauds which have been the largest have left a trail of destruction. When we talk of frauds, it is not these small-time employee fraud. There are the best systems, unfortunately, even detection systems for an employee. If you have to walk out of an office, you are frisked maybe. But what is it you will take? But the financial statement fraud, the trail of destruction it has left, share prices have come down by 90%. Investors have lost money. Employees whose savings are in shares of the company have lost money. They have lost jobs. Suppliers have lost business. The company collapses. That is the big, big, big concern which happens. Why does financial statement fraud? And billions of dollars when you see whether it's closer home or anywhere. So let's come back to this subject of corporate fraud. Broadly, if you see, there are three types, we can say. The first is asset appropriation or misappropriation of assets. You have cash and non-cash assets. Somebody may take material, somebody may take cash, fine. The second, which is the fraudulent statements, which as I said, is the largest. You have financial and non-financial there. But the third clearly is corruption, where you have all of it which I have spoken to. But we need to address, why do people commit frauds? Broadly, three reasons. First, people commit fraud because there is a pressure or an incentive. Either pressure or an incentive. A person under pressure, he is deeply in debt, or a person's stock price is going down, a corporate management, they try and do something which they believe is temporary, and then good days will come again, so everything will be fine. Nobody will know. And that pressure, and that's the whole issue of pressure. Today you have quarterly financial reporting. Everybody looks at earnings per share. That itself puts pressure on managements to say, how do I maintain my earnings per share? We've had in the IT sector, some companies virtually being taken to the cleaners by the analysts just because their earnings did not match guidance. How unfair. But the pressure you can imagine is on those companies that you are also expected to meet what an analyst says should be the thing. So that creates a pressure to fudge or massage the numbers. And you say, okay, when good times comes, we will cover up. The second reason why frauds happen is opportunity. Why I'm giving these illustrations is when you're looking to detect frauds, you need to see, is this environment there? If that environment has all these signals, then sure enough, there could be instances of fraud and your detection mechanisms have to be even more tighter. So if there is pressure or if there is an incentive in some manner, you need to look at that. The second, as I said, is the opportunity. You find something lying unattended, there's nobody. You walk on a road, you find currency notes. Human nature is you'll pick it up. But if there is a television camera focusing on it, you'll pick it up and go to the nearest policeman and go and give it to him. But that's the hard reality. It was also a reality that behavior in India and behavior outside India of the same individual is completely different. And the third reason why frauds happen is rationalization or justification. People commit frauds because they want to pay back their employer. He's ill-treating them. He says, I will teach him a lesson. The second way of rationalization is everybody is taking money, so when I take also, it is normal. And that's a way of rationalizing. So fraud happens if everybody is putting his hand in, fine. Costs of frauds, very, very significant. The largest cost is financial statement fraud. It goes into millions and millions of dollars. I don't have to tell you that. But the real issue which I want to bring out is, what are the studies which have shown as to how frauds were discovered? And amazingly, perhaps rightly, most frauds are discovered based on information which is provided or a confession, which is, if you see the study, 43% of the frauds are discovered based on information which has been provided, not by detection mechanisms. Accident, 7% of the frauds have been discovered by accident. You happen. You yourself look at any of these frauds. How many of those have been detected either by the internal auditor or the statutory auditor or by a regulator or even by the independent director as you would like to have? Internal audit has detected, this is 14% of the frauds. This is on a survey done across 2,000 companies by the Association of Certified Fraud Examiners. Now, if this is so, if fraud detection arises primarily on account of information, our focus therefore has to be, how do we get that information? No doubt you will have your tools, but if you also see statistics as to how long fraud has been perpetrated, what type of fraud, what is the average duration of the fraud, then you will find that the duration ranges somewhere as high as 36 months in certain types of fraud. In some it is lower. Then I'll also come to who commits fraud and what perhaps are the skills of a fraudster in a way. But why does the fraud happen in some cases? The study again by the Association of Certified Fraud Examiners says that lack of internal controls, 35% of the frauds are on account of lack of internal controls. Override of internal controls is 20%. Lack of management review is also equal 18 to 19%. So this is what I said, an opportunity. There is no control, there is no review, nobody is looking, I might as well take it. Who perpetrates fraud? And that's a very interesting thing as to who perpetrates fraud. The largest part of the fraud is perpetrated by people within the organization, employees, and of course the higher amounts of fraud are by the management. They say the median loss, the studies have shown, is frauds perpetrated by senior management is $500,000, median loss. And the larger the fraud is committed by people who are most trusted. But in terms of number, the largest number of frauds are perpetrated by people who are less than 5 years in an organization. And if you want to look at signals of fraudster, I will never quote signals of fraudster because it will have all those signals which says a person is God-fearing, a person is hard-working, very organized. Naturally, a fraudster has to be organized. He can't be disorganized. He's very hard-working. He has to be. He doesn't take leave. He's possessive of his work. He doesn't want anybody to do it. All those qualities which sometimes when I look in the mirror, maybe I too have. But that is, so nobody will have that fraud label saying, I am a fraudster, you know. That it's impossible to find out who is a fraudster. So we shouldn't really look at who is a fraudster. But we need to really look at the subject matter of fraud prevention. Fraud detection is all what you have. And fraud deterrence, and I'll come back to that. But before that, I spoke about all of this misappropriation of assets and all of it. But I believe the fraud which cannot easily be detected and you will not feel it is theft of information. I've known companies, certain companies losing business, regularly losing in tenders. It's because their internal information has gone out. Now, when there is theft of information, you have it, somebody else has it. When it's theft of an asset, you know it is missing. But when it's theft of information, you don't know. And believe me, in this technology world, technology-driven fraud, including theft of information, is something which is of magnitude. Since you don't feel it, you may not know. You may not know how deep it is in your organization in terms of information going out or information about what you're doing. So confidentiality is a huge issue, and that is also fraud, mind you. If I can get what your plans are, that is fraud. You will not know about it. So let me come back before I close on this whole issue, therefore, on fraud prevention. So if you can't eradicate fraud, you can mitigate. Now we'll come to these two things on mitigation and, in a way, prevention in a larger way. You need to create a culture. And surely that culture has to be at the dominant at the top, and you need to drive home ethical behavior. Well, that's good in theory. It brings us back to, do you incentivize good behavior, or do you have penalized abhorrent behavior? And if you do an analysis of all of what the laws are, where successful countries are, successful companies are, you will find it has worked very well where there is a deterrence. There has to be fear. And that fear will, that high degree of fear will ensure that the person does not cross the tipping point. And it is therefore, that would mean therefore, any action has to be swift, fair, and certain. If you know, it's like, we all know what's good for us. I knew years ago that I have to wear a seatbelt. It's a different matter, my car didn't have a seatbelt those days. After that, when cars had seatbelt, there was no law, the seatbelt was hanging on the side. When law came in, some of us put the seatbelt, but only when it was being enforced very strictly, everybody wore the seatbelt. That's a simple example of knowing what is good for you, but not doing it for only fear brought in. Today, in many cities, people don't drive past a red light because there is a camera, and you will get your challan for sure. It drives behavior. You need to have strong deterrence to drive behavior. And therefore, let me close by saying, if fraud detection, coming back to detection, which is the subject, has happened primarily because of information, the largest, we need to have a very strong whistleblower mechanism. I've seen in certain countries outside India, the whistleblower mechanism is so effective. Audit committees get 700 cases at a time of whistleblowers. And it's not just enough. What does that mechanism mean? Mechanism means creating an environment where people are able to blow the whistle. And when people are able to blow the whistle, it's people inside, people outside. Nobody can perpetrate a fraud easily because there is already somebody who is in the know in some way. So creating that environment where people blow the whistle, B, collecting that whistle blowing information mechanism, 3, acting on it, 4, protecting the whistleblower, and 5, taking action against those who have perpetrated a fraud. These, I believe, would go a long way insofar as dealing with the fraud. Thank you very much. Fraud detection, coming back to detection, which is the subject, has happened primarily because of information, the largest. We need to have a very strong whistleblower mechanism. I've seen in certain countries outside India, the whistleblower mechanism is so effective. Audit committees get 700 cases at a time of whistleblowers. And it's not just enough. What does that mechanism mean? Mechanism means creating an environment where people are able to blow the whistle. And when people are able to blow the whistle, it's people inside, people outside. Nobody can perpetrate a fraud easily because there is already somebody who is in the know in some way. So creating that environment where people blow the whistle, B, collecting that whistleblowing information mechanism, 3, acting on it, 4, protecting the whistleblower, and 5, taking action against those who have perpetrated a fraud. These, I believe, would go a long way insofar as dealing with the fraud. Thank you very much.